Paul Mobley is a nationally recognized award-winning photographer. For over 20 years, he has been hired by the largest corporations of the world and has photographed hundreds of famous faces. Paul has published 4 best-selling books: American Farmer, Everyday Heroes, If I Live to Be 100, and American Firefighter. For all 4 books, Mobley traveled around the country to meet his subjects in their hometowns and photograph these ordinary citizens leading their extraordinary lives. Paul has appeared on CNN, The Today Show, Martha Stewart, and many other national network broadcasts. Paul is here today to inspire you by sharing real-life images and the stories behind them, giving us a snapshot of modern-day agriculture and rural America.
Thank you, Kevin. Ladies and gentlemen, my American Farmer book was a life-changing accident. An accident. You see, I'm a city boy. I do commercial photography in New York, and I had never set foot on a farm in my life. Years ago, I decided I needed a break. I needed a break from photography, and I needed a break from that big, crazy city. So I packed my car, threw the dog in the back seat, and decided to spend one entire summer at my cabin in northern Michigan and not take one picture. Well, there's this coffee shop in town. I'd been going there for years. And on one particular day, I walked in and saw 4 farmers sitting at a table. I looked across the room, and everything changed. I saw those faces, and I knew I had to photograph those guys. So I walked up to the table, and I said to one of them, I said, "Excuse me, sir, would you mind if I take your picture?" And he looked up at me, he said, "Son, why would you want to take a picture of an ugly old guy like me? I haven't taken a bath in a week." Well, ladies and gentlemen, the rest is history. That summer, I photographed every farmer in the county. So much for taking the summer off. Well, I went back to New York City and took the photographs and showed a publisher. And she said, "These are amazing, but you've only got 30 people. So why don't we hit the road and let's create a masterpiece, Paul. These stories, they need to be told." So before I get into the presentation with you, I want to give you the facts, because people ask me all the time. It took me 4 years of my life, ladies and gentlemen, to make this book. 4 years. I traveled 100,000 miles. I went to 37 states, New York to Florida, across Texas, California, up through the great Northwest, and obviously right through the middle of the great Midwest. I took 40,000 pictures. But I'll tell you, this is what I got out of the deal: a lifetime of memories. There is not a day that goes by that I don't think of you. Not a day. And all the things that happened along the way, which I'm going to share with you. People ask me, "Paul, all the driving, all the pictures, all the cameras, who was the very first guy you photographed?" Well, I told you about the guy who said he hadn't taken a bath in a week. Well, here he is. This is Donnie the pig farmer from Honor, Michigan. He wasn't lying. I don't think he took a bath. But I remember, I've been taking pictures for 35 years, and I remember looking through the camera at this and thinking, this is the most pure and honest photograph that I've ever made. And to think that if I would have left my camera home that summer, I probably wouldn't be here with you today. So I embarked on this project in search of artistic evolution, and I found it. But the unexpected discovery for me was a kinder and gentler America than I had ever known. Our agricultural communities are the hidden secret of our country. I was inspired and humbled by the generosity and the warmth that was shown to me. I look back at it now and it almost feels like a fantasy, a dream. I remember the first state that I went to after I left Michigan. I went to New Mexico. First time on a farm, I pull up the driveway, get out of my rental car, here come the dogs running down the driveway to greet me. And I walk up to the house and I say, hello, is anybody home? No answer. So I walk around to the side of the house and I said, hello, is anybody home? No answer. I'm terrible at directions, so I'm probably on the wrong farm. So I went around the back and I saw a kitchen window open and I said, hello, is anybody home? And a woman said, come on in. The door's open. The door was always open. Farm after farm, ranch after ranch, always open for me. So I did what I always do. I walked in, I said hi to mom and dad. We talked about the farm, we talked about the legacy, we talked about everything agriculture related. And then I went outside and took my pictures. When I was finished, I walked back in, put my equipment away, said goodbye to dad, and I looked at mom and I said, thanks so much for having me. And she gave me a pained look. And I wasn't sure what that meant. Did I say something wrong? But she gave me that look. So I finished packing up, and I said goodbye to dad again, and then I went over to mom and I said, thank you very much for having me, and she gave me that look again. And I said, excuse me, ma'am, is everything okay? And she looked at me and she said, yeah, everything's okay. We just thought you were gonna stay here with us tonight. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this does not happen in New York City. And I thought she was just joking until I went to say goodbye and I opened the front door. And as soon as I grabbed that handle, and I remember it like yesterday, I looked and there was a bedroom right there. And inside the bedroom was a single bed with sheets pulled back perfectly, a cup of milk, two cookies, and a name card that said Paul. That was my first experience in agriculture. And I thought, my friends are never going to believe this. But here's the truth. I have a story like that for every single picture that I took. Friendship. Boy, it took me a very short time to realize the friendships that are made in agriculture. I remember pulling up to the gentleman's farm in the red shirt. His name was Ben. And the idea was just to photograph Ben. So I pulled up and he's standing on his porch and he said, welcome, young man. He said, I'm ready for my Hollywood moment. And I said, Ben, you look good. He said, yes, I do, and I'm ready for my pictures. And I walked up to him and could not have been more gracious, and we took pictures. And as I'm photographing him, I noticed somebody peeking around the side of the house. And as soon as I turned, this gentleman would pull back. So finally, I'm almost finished, and a gentleman in a blue shirt comes walking up. And I said, Ben, who's this? He said, this is my friend Carl. He wanted to come and watch you take my picture. I said, great. I said, who's Carl? And Ben composed himself and he said, Paul, let me tell you who Carl is. Carl and I started playing when we were 5 years old. We went to nursery school together. We went to middle school together. We went to high school together. We dated the same girl together. He went off to war. I went off to war. He came back and bought the farm down the street, and I came back and bought this farm right here. He goes, Paul, let me tell you who Carl is. He's been my best friend for 75 years. Now, I don't want to keep going back to New York City, but I thought about that for a minute and thought, if you have a friend in the city for 75 days, you're doing pretty darn good. People come, they go. But I remember leaving that farm thinking, how many of us are lucky enough to have a friend for that long? Someone who stays by us through thick and thin. I'd never seen it, but I guess it's just ordinary for everyone in agriculture. It was a really good reminder. Family, the family unit, how important is it? Well, anybody in this room could have taken this picture. Show up to a Wyoming ranch, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful day, you've got a beautiful horse, beautiful family. And the original picture, all three of them were just dressed like they were, standing right there, and I snapped the photograph. Turned out great. It wasn't until I said, hold on, you guys, I want to switch cameras. So I walked over to the trunk of my car, flipped up the hood, reached in to grab my camera, and I turned around and saw what you see on the screen right now. Now, when this happens, photographers get high blood pressure really fast because we see something like this and we're worried that it's going to go away. So we don't look in the lens, we don't look in the viewfinder, we just push the button and pray to God that it doesn't go away. Because as soon as that little girl heard me, she turned around. One of the greatest photographers that ever lived, that I admired through my whole career, had a saying. He said, some of the best pictures that have ever been made in the history of photography are the ones that leave us with unanswered questions. We want to know more. And when we were editing and looking at these images, I knew that this was the one we were going to choose because I want to know more. Who is this family? But for me, it was more of a representation of the solid family unit that I saw farm after farm after farm after farm after ranch. The family is the most important thing. I remember this picture, and I only show it because when I got there, the idea was to photograph Dad, who's right in the middle. And when I got there, everyone in the family was working. Nobody was sitting around, nobody was texting, everybody was working. And I said, Dad, is this your family? He said, yes, it is. I'm very proud. And I said, well, how about if we take a picture of the entire family? And he said, oh, that'd be great. So I get everybody set up. And all of a sudden, I'm standing behind the camera, and there is a very large animal running crazy, kicking up dirt, driving everybody crazy. And I said, Dad, who's this? And he goes, Paul, listen, I'll take care of him if he doesn't settle down. And I said, okay. I said, who is he? He said, Paul, that's Brutus. I said, is he part of the family? He goes, that's our boy, Paul. So I walked up to him, and I took the dog by the collar, and I put him right where I wanted him. And right at that moment, he stopped running and going crazy and actually smiled. And the funny thing about it is I always go back. I remember my editor saying to me, Paul, that dog saved your life. Without that dog in the picture, it's a nice picture, but having Brutus in there was a great thing. Here's another family. I was in California, and I had heard about the Rigettis. And I remember driving to their farm and seeing the most beautiful rolling land that I'd ever seen. And when I pulled up to the farm, this very gentle man came out on the porch and he said, hi, Paul, I'm Ernie Rigetti. He said, have you ever seen a really beautiful avocado? And I said, no, Mr. Rigetti, I guess I haven't. He said, get in the truck. So as you can imagine, a very old truck that was full of rust, all the tires were different. I get in the truck and here we are and we're driving. And I'm looking over at his face and he's smiling ear to ear. And he starts to tell me, he said, I want you to know, my dad and I started this with five trees. Five. And everything you see all around you is what we created. And photographers, we tend to be very observant. And I could not get over the joy and the pride in his face as he was driving around and showing me all these avocados. He said, my boys and I are taking it now, and their boys will take it from there. But what's really funny about the story is when I pulled in, after Mr. Rigetti had shown me the property and the farm, and here's Mrs. Rigetti on the front porch, the door slammed, she says, you're staying for lunch, aren't you? And I said, sure, what are we having? And she said, avocados. I know she was joking, till I walked inside. We go into a kitchen, round white tablecloth, eight white chairs, you know what I'm talking about. Here comes Mrs. Rigetti out of the kitchen with a platter this big of perfectly sliced avocados. She puts the plate in the middle of the table. Now the boys dive right in, start eating. Now, I'm thinking in my mind, I should probably wait because there's going to be some chicken or a steak or something that's going to accompany these avocados. Never happened. So finally, I'm looking and I said, Mrs. Rigetti, and she says, son, you better eat your lunch or you're going home on an empty stomach. And I said, well, what are we having with the avocados? And she put two pieces of white bread on my plate and said, make yourself a sandwich, that's all you're getting. True story. Best avocados I ever had. But for me, when you look at this photograph, it was yesterday I feel like I made it. And it's a very simple picture, but if you look at Dad and you look at his face, just look at the boys. They're all the same. They're all the same. They're all the same, if you look at. So the family for me was a strong reminder what's important in life after doing these. Here is a gentleman that I want to talk to you about. We had gotten into probably halfway through the book, and it didn't take me long to realize that the women on the farms, I call them the unsung heroes, the backbone of the farms. So many times behind the scene I would see, mom was doing this, the girls were doing that. A vital part of the everyday operation. So I called my publisher up and I said, you know, I would like to add some more women to the book. I'm seeing things that we just need to photograph a lot more of them. And She called me a couple of days later and said, listen, there's a woman we keep hearing about in Nebraska, and her name is Ladine Rutt. And she's the lady right there. And she goes out of her way to help farmers when they're in need. She does bake sales. She's an incredible seamstress. She makes sweaters and blankets, but always helping with the Nebraska Farm Bureau. She's your person. So I remember calling Ladine up and saying, hi, Ladine, it's Paul Mobley. I would love to come and take your picture. I've heard so many things about you. And she said, Paul, that would be great, but you have to promise me one thing. And I said, sure, what's that? And she said, if my husband Larry says one thing about motorcycles, you'll ignore him and walk away. Okay, no problem, Ladine. So I remember pulling up to their farm, and right out of the front door of the house, here comes Larry. Paul, hey, nice to meet you. Hey, I want to show you my bikes. I said, Larry, I promised Ladine that there would be no, oh, don't listen to her. Come with me. So we go over to a pole barn right on the property, and all of a sudden, he brings that door up, and inside of that pole barn are 40 motorcycles lined up beautifully like soldiers. And I said, wow, that's pretty incredible. He goes, yeah, I told you, right? I knew you'd want to see them. And I said, Larry, he says, listen, what Ladine didn't tell you was that we ride these motorcycles all over the country and help farm families. Whenever a farmer or a family's in need, we get on these bikes and we run around and help, and we go all over the country to try to spread the good word. Anything we can do to help another one of us, we're always there. I said, that's incredible. Which bike's your favorite bike? And he goes, oh, that one right there. And I said, okay. Why don't we bring it out quietly and let's see if maybe, just maybe, we can get a picture with you and Ladine. Oh, that'd be great, he says. So meanwhile, he's pushing that bike, ladies and gentlemen, out in front, right past the front of the house, and I see Ladine standing there looking like this, giving me that look. And I walked up to her and she said, Paul, you promised me. And I said, no, Ladine, we're not going to do it. I'm just doing this to warm him up. She says, trust me, he doesn't need to be warmed up. And I said, no, you'll see. I know what to do. And she shook her head, and she said, okay, I warned you. So we do all the pictures. And here comes a storm. Storm's coming in, and for a photographer, no better time to take pictures. So here comes the clouds and the sky's getting real angry. And I said, Ladine, we're all finished. I said, you know what? Larry was so good. Why don't we just do one picture with the motorcycle? And she said, okay, I warned you. So I find a great spot and put the motorcycle right there. And I said, now, Ladine, here's what I want you to do. I want you to hold the helmet and just lean up against that motorcycle and just look at me and smile. She walks right up, perfect. I said, now, Larry, I just want you to sit on the bike with your helmet and just look at me. Well, he walks up to the front of the bike and goes like this and stares me down. And I said, Larry, what's that? He said, well, I'm a biker. This is how we pose. I said, Larry, you're a farmer. No, I'm a biker right now. And I said, well, listen, that pose isn't going to work. And now the sky's getting better and better. And I said, let's do something, change yourself. So instead of doing this, he does this and gives me the big chest. And I'm behind the camera, kneeled down like this, and I'm taking pictures and I'm looking through the lens thinking, this is the saddest thing in the world because this is such a beautiful picture. Ladine looks great, the sky looks great, but he's ruined the shot. So I'm shooting 10, 20, 30, and then finally we're getting to this, and every ridiculous pose, And finally, I thought, this is really a shame. I'm going to call it a wrap, as we say. So as I'm kneeling down, getting ready to say, that's it, I feel something on my shoe. And as I turn around, here comes Morris the cat, coming through the grass. And right at that moment, he comes up and jumps up into Larry's arms. Now, Larry has not smiled, ladies and gentlemen, in one picture. As soon as that cat jumped up in his arm, I snapped the photo. And he goes, you're not going to use that one, are you? And I said, oh, no, 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 I'd never use that one. No, I'd never use that. And I'm thinking, oh, my God. So I get back to New York, and the editor's looking at these pictures, all this craziness, and saying, Paul, what's going on here? I can't use any of this. And I said, keep going, Carol, keep going. She gets to shot number 44, and it's this one. And she snaps her hands, and she goes, oh, my God, Paul. Genius, the cat saved your life. I love this picture so much, I'm going to put it in the center of the book. I said, great. Now, I can't wait to call Ladine, everybody. So phone ring, ring, ring. I said, hey, Ladine, it's Paul Mobley. She didn't even get to say, hi, Paul, when I heard in the background, he's not using that one with a cat, is he? I said, Ladine, you're not going to believe it. I said, this picture with the cat is one of the best pictures in the book. And she pauses and says, Paul, let me tell you something. He's been saying, don't listen to Ladine, but I'm going to tell you today, don't listen to Larry. He sleeps with that darn cat every night. So, fathers and their sons. I have two girls, so I can't say I relate, but I understand. I remember going to this farm, and the gentleman in the very back, whose dad, was the only person I was going to go and photograph. Now, dads, you're going to totally appreciate what I'm saying. I got there, and I saw the boys just breaking their backs, working so hard. And I walked up to Dad, and I said, Dad, are these your boys? He said, yep, I'm very proud. And I said, we got to photograph them. And he said, that's great. I said, have you ever had a picture with you and your boys? And he said, no, son, I haven't. And I said, why not? Always working. And I said, well, we're going to change that right now. So I remember lining this up and looking through the camera and thinking to myself, he's going to die when he sees this. This is incredible. And I decided I wanted to make it black and white because in our world, if a picture's black and white, it kind of makes it timeless, something he'll look back on and the boys will look back on. So I couldn't wait to get back to the studio and blow one up, a picture, and send it to him. So I put it in the mail, and my phone rang, and I remember picking up the phone and him saying, hi, Paul, this is John. You took a picture with me and my boys. Now, I want to walk you through exactly how this happened so you can understand. This is how he's telling me the story. He said, the other day, I went down to the mailbox. He says, I opened the mailbox, brought the mail in, and I saw a manila envelope. He said, I opened the envelope up, pulled out the tissue and the cardboard, and then the phone went dead. I couldn't hear it. And all of a sudden, I'm listening, and he's sobbing. And he said, Paul, I'm sorry. He said, but these boys mean so much to me, and what we've created here is something I could never have imagined. And I'm just so grateful that you would send this to me. I'm going to hang it above my fireplace. Now, my business is a really hard business. Most photographers don't make a good living. My father was opposed to me doing this when I told him I was going to go to New York. And I've been one of the small percentage that's been able to make a living at it. But of all the joy, to me, being able to move a person to tears, especially a grown man, with the work that you do, is why I do it. And to sit and think that this man will treasure this, and it's all about his boys. It's all about his boys. So I say it all the time. Tell your boys you love them, because you never know. You never know. But that's why I'm a photographer, is that reason right there. This is a picture that anybody in this room could have taken. I had never been to a sunflower farm. I'd never seen one. It's concrete, buildings everywhere I look. But I remember going there and getting so excited because I'd never seen so much color. If I photograph from low, beautiful. If I get on a ladder, beautiful. Not a bad picture. Every picture I took was great. But what I love about the picture is it's father and son. And just the integrity, the glance, the look in their eyes is everything. It's everything. It's everything. Of all the stories I've told you today, I'm hoping that you'll take this one with you. If there's one story you could say, you know, that guy told a lot of stories. This is the one I hope you remember and think about when you leave here. We all know somebody in their life, in our lives, that no matter what life brings them, they always have a smile on their face. I know a lot of people that are angry all the time, especially where I come from. But we all know that one person, and that person is in this picture in the yellow shirt named Bob. From the second that I met Bob and got out of my car to photograph him, he smiled like I'd known him for 50 years and shook my hand and said, I'm glad to know you. Come on in, let me show you around. But I also want you to know I'm an amateur photographer. And in my spare time, I like to take pictures. So maybe someday you can help me and give me some pointers. I said, great. So we talked, he showed me the pictures on his wall. And then all of a sudden I said, Bob, let's get out and take some pictures. He opens the front door and standing there with his arms out with a stack of wood higher than his hat is a man. He puts the wood down. I said, who is that? He said, that's my dad, Elmer. And I said, oh my God, he looks like a movie star. He goes, don't tell him that, Paul, trust me. And I said, wow. I said, we have to take his picture, you and him together. And he said, oh, he'll love that. And I said, wow, tell me about your dad. And he said, well, see that little building over there? I said, yep. He said, that's where he was born and grew up. It was no bigger than this stage from here. He said, we moved that over there, Paul, so every day when we walk out the front door, it reminds us to be humble, to be kind, and never forget where we came from. But he is a trooper. He gets up at 5 in the morning and works till 10 at night, day after day after day. And I said, well, we have to take your picture. So every picture I took of the two of them was great. So we left, and I shook his hand, and he smiled, and he said, you know, you sure you don't mind if I call you for some photography tips? I'll bother you in that crazy city you live in. And I said, Bob, anytime. So I shook his hands, said goodbye. The following Friday at 9 a.m. New York time, the phone rings. I look down at my caller ID. It's Bob from Montana. I'm like, wow. So I pick up the phone. I said, hello. He says, hey, Paul, it's your friend Bob from Montana. He said, how is things going in that rotten city? And I said, Bob, they're great. And he says, how's your family? How's your dad? It's all he wanted to know was how my family was, how I was doing, and we talked 30 minutes about nothing, really. But I felt, what a nice man. Not that I'm surprised at this point in my journey. So I said, well, I'm waiting for him to get to what he wants. And he said, I hope you have a nice day, Paul. I'll see you later. Bye-bye. The following Friday at 9 o'clock, on the nose, phone rings again. Hey, Paul, it's Bob. I said, hi, Bob. Now I know he's going to call for the thing he forgot the week ago. How are you? How are things? Same thing, just to check up on me. Every Friday at 9 a.m., week after week after week, to the point where I would get my coffee, get in my chair, and be ready for my talk with Bob, which was just friendly conversation between two human beings and just sharing stories. So, always in a good mood. After talking to him, I realized, you got nothing to complain about, Paul. Nothing. Always, talk to you later. So this went on for months. And he was always in a good mood. And on one particular Friday, I picked up the phone. I said, hi, Bob, how are you today? And he said, Paul, I'm not so good. And I said, what's wrong? And he said, well, Elmer was on the tractor the other day, and he came around the corner a little too fast. He flipped the tractor, and he died instantly. He said, and I really would hate to bother you with this because I know you're busy. He said, but that picture you took of my dad and I meant so much to me. I wanted to see if you'd be kind enough to send me one so I could put it in his casket. And I said, Bob, I'll do it today. I said, I'm so sorry. What a great man he was, and I feel so bad. And obviously, if somebody is so interested in your work that they want to do that. So I sent the photograph to Bob, and Friday went by, another Friday went by, another Friday went by. I never heard from Bob. And I remember sitting with my publisher, and she said, what's wrong? And I said, you know, I said, I miss that phone call every Friday. I said, it was just, nobody wanted anything. It was just two human beings being nice to each other. I said, and I can't tell you how much I miss it in the chaos of my normal work. And she looked at me, she said, he'll call. Don't worry, Paul. He'll call. So week after week went by, and then one Friday, the phone rings, and I look down at the caller ID, and I don't know whether to scream with excitement or, but I pick up the phone. I said, hello. And he said, hey, Paul, it's Bob. And I said, hi, Bob. He says, I am so, so sorry that I haven't called. He said, losing my dad was really, really hard, but everybody loved the photograph, and I'm very, very grateful that you would send it to me. And he was right back to his old self. He said, so I look forward to our Friday conversations. And ladies and gentlemen, to this day, we still talk at 9 o'clock on Friday morning. And here's the best part of the story. He has never asked me for a photography tip in 5 years. Wow. Cherish your friends. We can't leave the fathers and the daughters out. I remember going up to this farm, and this man, his name was Keith, he was a very tall, large, big man. And I remember walking up to him, shaking his hand, and his hand was twice as big as mine. And he shook this hand, and it is still not the same today. But we started talking, and we hadn't been discussing for 2 minutes, and he went in to talk about his daughter, Tiffany. He says, "Paul, I'm really upset that you couldn't meet my daughter, Tiffany." He said, "You know, we raised her on the farm since she was just a baby girl, and she's just the apple of my eye." And he went on and on and on about Tiffany. And I said, "Well, we have to take a picture of you and Tiffany." He says, "Well, I'm sorry, that's not possible. It's only 10 o'clock in the morning, and she doesn't get home from school till 3. And how he talked about his daughter, I thought, you know what? I'll wait. So we had some sandwiches. He gave me a ride in his combine, my first ride. And like everybody else, just talked about life. 3 o'clock, up the driveway walked this beautiful young lady, smiling. And I'm the observant one. I look back at Keith, and he just lights up. He's so excited to introduce me to his daughter. And she comes up and says, "Hello." And Keith said, "Paul, I want you to meet my daughter, Tiffany." And he was so proud. And I said, "Well, Tiffany, we waited because Dad wants a picture with you." And she said, "Okay." So I found a perfect spot. And I just stood the two of them together. So one of the things I failed to mention to you was my old college professor in photography school used to say to me, "The best pictures, Paul, are the ones that are in between, not the obvious one. It's what happens in between, like the family that turned their back. So always keep your eyes peeled and that trigger pulled, because you never know." So I took a nice picture of the two of them, and I went over to my car. Same thing. I said, "Hold on, you guys. I'm going to get another lens." Opened up my trunk, grabbed a lens, and turned around and saw what you guys see. Same thing, blood pressure, whole thing. Click, 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 as fast as I can, because as soon as she was obviously very embarrassed and she pulled away from Dad. But obviously I love this picture, and everybody loves it too, but they always say the same thing. They always say, "Oh, she looks so great." Well, she does, but if you look closely, they always say a great photograph, it's always in the eyes, right? Look at Keith's eyes. That's a proud dad. That's a proud dad. So when I went over, and now I go to another farm and meet another young man, and I'm only supposed to photograph him. His name's Ted, and as soon as I get to his farm, I see a woman, maybe 4.5 feet tall, carrying 2 Home Depot orange buckets full of water. And I said, "Ted, who's that?" "Oh, that's my mom. She's 93. Now, I've been on this journey 2 years, and I realized, you know what I got to do? I got to get out of New York City. I got to get myself a farm, because I'm guaranteed to live a better and longer life. I'm photographing 80-year-olds, 90-year-olds. She's 93. And I said, "Well, I'd like to photograph you and your mom." He said, "Well, I don't know if she'll do it." And I said, "Why not?" She goes, "Because she's always working. Gets up before everybody else and works till dark." And I said, "Well, I'll go talk to her." I said, "She'll probably be nice to me." And he goes, "Be careful." So I walked up to her and I said, "Excuse me, ma'am." I said, "Would you mind if I took a photograph with you and your son?" And she goes, "Hurry it up, son. Hurry it up. I got a lot to do here." So I put him where I want him. I bring her around the back, and I put her next to him. The problem is she's so little, she's looking through the fence like she's in the penitentiary. So what do? I turn that Home Depot bucket over, picked her up, put her on that bucket, and now I got a picture. But here's the thing. I stopped to pause and realize I photographed plenty of 80-year-olds. I got a bunch of 90-year-olds. I even have some 100-year-olds. So that's what I want to do. Farming equals long life. Farming equals a great life, happy life. So I called up my publisher and I said, I want to start photographing more 100-year-olds. Let's look for them, and we call them centenarians. She said, no problem. So at this point, we had determined that Willard Scott, the guy who does the weather, or used to do the weather on the Today Show, little did we know, but he does the Smuckers thing. So we figured we'd call him and see if he could help us find some 100-year-old farmers. We call up, and his producer jumps on the phone and says, I bet you didn't know that Willard comes from a four-generation farm family in Virginia. He loves agriculture, loves it. He'll help you. And we get people all the time, but we'll get back to you. Now, in my business, when somebody says we'll get back to you, they don't get back to you. I never hear from them. I hear it all the time. Love your work, Paul, we'll get back to you. Well, a couple of weeks actually go by, phone rings, and I look down at my caller ID, and it says NBC News. So I thought, this is either going to be a good call, or I'm in big trouble. But I got to take this call. So I pick up the call. Lady says, Paul, this is Lysandra from NBC, Willard's assistant. And I said, nice to meet you. She said, you know, I think I got a good one for you. And I said, what's that? She said, yesterday, the oldest woman in the world from Korea passed away. And because of that, there is a farmer's wife from Shelbyville, Indiana. Her name is Edna Parker, and she's 115 years old. And we talked to her and her family and told her what you wanted to do, and they were excited you were going to do it. But I'm in the news business, Paul, and I'm going to give you some really good advice. I would get in your car right now and go get that picture. So I'm driving to Shelbyville with my assistant, and I have to tell you, I was really nervous. And I've photographed a lot of famous people and important people and every kind of people you'd want to photograph, but my assistant looks at me, he says, Paul, what are you, you're shaking. And I said, oh, no reason to be, not to be nervous. I'm only going to photograph the oldest person alive right now. I better not screw it up. And he says, Paul, you'll be fine. Just do what you do. So I walk in to the center that she's at. And there's a very nice lady, and she says, oh, you must be here for Edna. And I said, yes. And she said, she's down the hall in the library waiting for you. Now keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, I have never seen what this person looks like, so I have no idea what I'm coming into. So I start to take this walk, and I'm like, I feel like my knees are gonna give out. I'm so nervous. And I turn and look in the library, and I see a small woman with a full head of white hair looking out the window, and her back's facing me. And I'm just standing there. I don't make a sound, and she says, Paul, is that you? And she turns around, and I said, Edna, how did you know? She says, Paul, at my age, you just know. Come in here and tell me about this book. And I walked in and sat down with her, and I'll never forget it. She held my hands. Now try to imagine a woman's hands that's worked outside at 115 years old. And she looked down at me, and we were talking, and obviously I took the picture. I made it black and white for all the reasons. And I knew when the end of the photo session was finished that I'd probably never see her again. And there was a profound sadness that came over me. And I said, Edna, I'm really grateful for this opportunity. And she said, come here and sit down. She says, I want you to remember one thing when you leave here. All of these farmers and people in agriculture that you've met, If you ever need anything, son, call them. They'll always be there for you. People in my world are special. They're kind. They're considerate. They'll always be there. So don't be afraid to pick up the phone. And I left. And about 6 months later, Edna passed away. The good news, the book wasn't out, but we had gotten her an advance copy. And I remember her daughter, who was like 88, said to me, "Paul, when Edna was scrolling through the book and got to her page, there was a twinkle in her eye that we hadn't seen in months. And because of her was the reason I did my last book called If I Live to Be 100. I was so moved by centenarians that I went all across the country and photographed everyone, in one person in each state that was over 100 years old. But Edna reminded me what I had known from the first farm that I went to, about the type of people and the quality of people I was dealing with. I have to tell you one other story about, because this is a great centenarian story that I always put in. This is Walter Jackson, 103 years old, citrus farmer from Florida. A wonderful man, jolly, happy, walked like this. Little guy, and he came out to my car and, "Nice to meet you." And I said, "Hi, Walter, it's really nice to meet you. Tell me about yourself." He says, "Well, I started picking oranges when I was 5 years old." He says, "I put three kids through college, and I never went to the county courthouse one time. My boys are beautiful, and farming and agriculture give me a great life." Now, at this point, my father starts getting in my ear because he's hearing that I'm photographing all these 100-year-olds. So he calls me one day. He says, "You know, son, you're photographing all these 100-year-olds. Did you ever ask any of them what the key to long life is?" I said, "Dad, that's ridiculous." I said, "They get asked that all the time. I'm not asking." He said, "Well, you should ask, because every one of them is going to give you a different answer." "Thanks, Dad. I'll talk to you later." So we're finishing photograph. Every picture I took of Walter was like this. And we're finishing, and I hear my dad on this shoulder kind of saying, "Ask him what the key to long life is." So I figured, I broke down and said, "Hey, Walter," I said, what's the key to long life?" And he stopped, and he looked, and he said, "You know, son, be kind to your neighbors. Take good care of your friends. Love your family as much as you can." And then he looked up at the sky and he said, "But for me, the good Lord's been awfully good to me, Paul. And I've learned when you see it, you push the button," because that's the one we ended up using. And I'm getting ready to leave. Every picture I took of him was great. And I get in my car, and Walter's walking up to his porch, to his front door, and I'm getting ready to close the door, and I said, "Bye, Walter." And he goes, hey, Sonny." I said, "Yeah, Walter." He said, "Could I ask you a question?" And I said, "Sure. What's that?" He says, could you get me a date with Oprah?" And I said, "Walter, if I get on Oprah, you're coming with me, because she will love you." And you know how older folks point when they talk. He says, "Well, that's good, son," he says, "because I could show her an awfully, awfully good time." What a great man. What a great story. So I've shown you everything I can show you, but I have to show you, we covered everything. Now I got twins, Gene and Dean, cherry farmers from Michigan. John and Don, two dairy farmers from Iowa. I got two bald heads in the moon. Come on. I got everything you can get. I met every person in ag you could meet. So one day, I get a phone call, and my publisher comes in, and she says, come on in here. I want to show you something. So I walk into the office, and she projects this picture up on the screen. And she said, did you take a look at this picture, the blueberry man you photographed in Maine? And I said, well, yeah. She goes, but did you look at that picture closely, Paul? And I said, well, I guess not. She said, you know, for 3 years, you've been telling us about this journey. And we've been sitting here in New York, jealous, wishing we could be there with you, loving every minute of everything you said. But if you look at this picture, the hands are shaped like a heart. Do you see the symbolism, Paul? Well, yeah. She said, these are the farmers giving back to you. This was their gift to you. And I said, I get it. And she said, I love this picture so much, I'm putting it on the back cover of the book. And I said, great. So I remember calling Jerry in Maine and saying, Jerry, it's Paul Mobley. Hi, Paul. I said, I've got good news and I've got bad news. And he said, what's the good news? I said, you made it on the back cover of the book. Oh, that's great. What's the bad news? Your head's not in it. And he did exactly what I thought he would do. He said, Paul, doesn't matter to me. I'm just glad to be part of it. I got the greatest job in the world. I get up every day. I do a hard day's work. I take good care of my family. I'm one of the lucky ones. I see it. Everyone in this room, you guys are the lucky ones. It's not that easy for everybody else. So, publisher says, Paul, you've been going on this book for 4 years. We got to finish. Is there anybody else you want to photograph? And I said, Lena, there is. I said, I had heard so much about Hurricane Katrina and all of the farmers that were impacted by that. I want to photograph a Katrina farmer. So I called a gentleman down at the Louisiana Farm Bureau who corrected me very quickly. And he said to me, Paul, let me start by telling you, Katrina got all the publicity, but Hurricane Rita, which the eye of Hurricane Rita came right up into Grand Chenier and wiped out everybody in the county. You want to photograph a Rita farmer. Well, he said, the problem is there was nobody left. He said, but there's one guy, and his name's Billy Dolan. Billy's your guy. You go down and let him tell you his story. So I go down and I meet Billy, and he starts to tell me when the storm came in, he'd been there 55 years. And when the storm came in, it wiped out everything. And he said that all his friends left. All his family had left. They either retired, they moved in with other family members, they moved out of state, but he decided he was going to stay. And what did he do? He said, Paul, I called every farmer that I knew and asked for a hand. And one by one by one, they came back and helped me rebuild my farm. The word got out, and people I didn't even know were showing up to help me. And I looked at him and I said, Billy, I said, I'm tired just hearing the story, the amount of work and effort I said, Billy, why did you stay? And here's what he said. He said, Paul, I was born on this land, and I will die on this land. And I thought, what a fitting ending to a great moment in my life was this picture. So I was getting ready to leave, and I always like to look in the little buildings. And I saw a building that I hadn't walked into that was looked like it was ready to fall to the ground. It was so old. I got out of my car and I walked, opened the door to the building, and I turned the corner and I saw this. And I couldn't believe my eyes. And I'm looking, and it was maybe the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen. So I called Billy up, and I said, Billy, come here. And he said, what's up, son? And I said, Billy, what is this? And he said, Paul, when the storm came through, I came back to see my land, and they wouldn't let me in. And I kept going to the barricade every day, and they kept saying, be another week, be another week. When they finally let me in, I walked and everything was gone. All my cattle, all my machines. He said, a couple of weeks before the storm, my wife sent me up to Walmart to buy a new flag. He said, the first thing I noticed was that flagpole was through a tree like an arrow. And day after day, day after day, I would walk around and I would see little parts of that flag. And I'd pick them up off the ground and I'd bring them into the barn. And I'd put them up here to remind me. This is my life. This is my home. And this is a reminder, Paul. I got my farm back. Well, ladies and gentlemen, these photos were really about the human connection more than anything, right? Think about the world today, and I've often wondered, where have all the good people gone? Well, I can tell you, drive up at any farmhouse in America and you'll find them. And you're here with me today. You're here with me today. This journey has been one of the greatest gifts of my life. And I hope what I've shared with you today honors the legacy of this fearless, patriotic group of Americans. We are all part of a great and resilient nation. And if you ever forget that, get to know a farmer. Your hand. It might make you think about your own legacy too. What are you doing to leave this world a little better than you found it? Well, if you can answer that question with pride, dignity, and confidence, then you already know what it took me 4 years and 100,000 miles to learn. That we are all stewards of this great land. Before I say goodbye to you, I want to thank every one of you for coming and taking the time to listen to my story. I want to thank the Von Trump family and FARMCON for having me. And I never, ever, ever leave this stage without saying to all of you, God bless you.
right, I want to, we're hot. I want to ball, come back out, and he's going to sign some books. He's got some books here. I think they're usually 100. I think he's doing them for 75 signed. They're awesome. They look great. I want to give him a warm applause and thank him for being here.
Thank you to everyone. Thank you so much.
Paul's going to set up down here. Start the line kind of down there. If you want to come up, talk to him, shake his hand, get a book, you're more than welcome. Paul, you're going to come out. You guys coming up to help. So I think that's it for today, and we'll be back at it tomorrow, bright and early, so it'll be good. Take the stage at 9. Some breakfast is going on. Be safe tonight. See you guys tomorrow. Come on up if you're interested in a book.